I've put a lot of work into this case, Pat, an awful lot. Now, it'll all go for nothing if you lose your cool in there. Do you understand?
Good luck, love. Don't let those bastards get you down. Remember, we're gonna beat them, okay?
Right. Yes, I understand. Well, kids, here we come, eh?
Take it.
Will you stop it?
You said I could carry it.
For heaven's sake, give it to me. Careful.
To the city hospital. It's not good, I'm afraid. I'm sorry about the kids. Look, I know it's not the right time, but I must ask a few questions if we're to find out who's responsible. We know where the bomb came from. A man left it at hotel reception early this afternoon. The point is, this man, whoever he is, probably didn't expect your wife and kids to visit. Were you expecting them? Then obviously the bomb was meant for you. We have a description. The fellow was in his late 20s, 5'11", slim build, good looks, light brown hair, moustache. Ring a bell?
Yes, it does.
What are you doing?
Waiting for you.
Your bag's packed.
There's no point in me hanging around here any longer, is there? Except for the money you owe me.
I said I'd pay you when the job gets done.
You delivered the package, didn't you?
Yes.
Then the job is done.
We don't know that. We don't know that Fletcher's been arrested.
The cops found that package. I made sure of that.
But what if they believe him? What if they think the drugs were a plant?
If they believe him, then they'd better not find me here, had they? Otherwise, they just might think that we set him up.
Okay. Perhaps you'd better clear out. But you'll have to wait for the money. I don't carry that sort of cash around with me.
Then you'd better go to the bank, hadn't you? Now, I'll come with you.
Okay.
Stand the radio on when I'm being driven, it distracts me.
Look, whose bloody car is this?
Just drive.
Your Honours, as you are no doubt aware from the preliminary hearings, this is rather an unusual appeal. Unusual in that it was lodged nearly 6 months after the original trial. And unusual in that, although my client is admitting guilt of her charges, there was in fact a miscarriage of justice brought about by the publicity surrounding my client's case. Publicity which alienated my client, but which in any humane society should have engendered a great deal of sympathy for her.
Miss Saunders, I hope you're not intending to give the court a lesson in sociology.
No, Your Honor. I'm hoping the court will give me a lesson in justice.
Then perhaps you'd get on to the subject of your evidence and give us that opportunity.
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. In very concise terms, the facts of the case are these. All the charges laid against my client arose directly from her desire to protect her eldest son, a desire that I'm sure any parent will understand. In Mrs. O'Connell's case, this desire had tragic consequences. Subsequent to her most recent trial, her eldest son hanged himself. Not that we are here to condone the crimes committed by Mrs. O'Connell's son. We do hope to prove, however, that it was the publicity surrounding these crimes which caused my client to receive so severe a sentence.
Mrs. Davidson, I thought perhaps you'd like to know. The women have decided to continue with the drama group.
The women or B. Smith?
Well, every group needs its leader. Bye-bye.
Mr. Pierce, come in, would you please? Mr. Reed tells me he left you alone with B. Smith earlier today.
Oh, not exactly. We were in his office when he went to get some coffee.
We both know that is not the reason why he left the room. Mr. Reed believes the end justifies the means. He breaks the rules when it suits him. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But he can afford to take chances. I'm not so sure you can.
Mrs. Davidson, I'm just here to run a drama group.
I know why you're here, but I'm not sure you know what you are letting yourself in for. Do you know why B. Smith is in here?
Murder.
Double murder. Her husband's lover, then her husband, several years apart. B. Smith is a passionate woman, and she holds grudges. If you're going to make deals with that sort of woman, Mr. Pierce, I think you should be aware of the dangers.
Hey, what the bloody hell's going on in here?
Having a smoke, eh?
Yeah, well, get on with it. I want this lot finished
today. We got plenty of time, B.
We haven't. Because we're starting the drama group again tomorrow.
How come?
Because I said so.
I thought you'd lost interest.
Yeah, well, I changed my mind.
Oh, one minute you tell us to do one thing and the next minute...
The police have now released the names of the victims. They are the wife and the children of a prison officer at the Wentworth Detention Centre, Mrs. Leela Fletcher and her two children. It is understood that the children died instantly in the blast and that Mrs. Fletcher has been rushed to the city hospital.
Mr. Fletcher?
Yes, Doctor. How is she?
Not good, I'm afraid. We'd like you to sign an operation release form.
Yes, of course. What are her chances?
With the operation? Well, without it, no hope at all. That's all I can say.
Your Honours, Dr. Miller is a professional man, a respected member of society, who has worked in close contact with criminal elements. Now, my purpose in asking him here as a character witness for my client is to demonstrate that although Mrs. O'Connell has admitted her guilt and been convicted, she is not of what one would call a criminal mentality. She is a victim of circumstances that would incite any woman of strong maternal feelings to break the law.
Very well. Proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Dr. Miller, did Mrs. O'Connell's behavior alter at any time during your period at Wentworth?
Well, no.
Dr. Miller, Mrs. O'Connell's prison record shows that on one occasion she attacked you. Is this correct?
Yes, Your Honor, but only under great stress. She'd been working hard to get parole so that she could be with her children. After the incident with David, her son, she found herself back inside. Then when she was told of his suicide, her control just snapped.
And was this the only occasion that she lost control?
To the best of my knowledge, Your Honor, yes.
Very well. Proceed, Miss Saunders.
What's the matter?
I'll get a parking ticket.
Oh, just leave the keys in the car. If he says anything, I'll move it. What's up now? Do you think I'm going to pinch the bloody car or something?
No.
Well, get a move on. My mate's just gone in to pick up the office wages. It'll only be a minute.
Here's more news concerning the bombing in Melbourne today. Police have issued the description of a man they wish to question over the incident. He's in his late 20s with light brown hair, slim build and a moustache. Would anyone knowing the whereabouts of this man please contact Detective Parsons of Melbourne CIB. Police now believe that the three people involved in the blast, a woman and her two small children, were not the intended victims. And just repeating that description again, the man the police wished...
I trust you, mate. We're partners, aren't we? I just heard a bulletin on the radio. The cops are talking to Fletcher, so it's all over. There is one last favour you could do me. Just drive me to a mate's place.
Look, I can't. I've got an appointment.
You would want to know where I was, just in case something went wrong, wouldn't you? Look, it's not far. It's just up the road. Come on.
I think that's about everything, Mr. Simpson. Now, does he drive a car?
Yes.
You know the type?
It's a Commodore, a cream Commodore.
Registration number?
I'm not sure.
That's all right, we can check that at the station.
Are you sure he's responsible?
Well, we can't be certain until we've spoken to him, but you heard the description, and he had the motive. Look, I'll be leaving a policeman outside the door. If he should try to contact you, you'll let us know, won't you?
Sergeant, which hospital is Mrs. Fletcher in?
City General.
And Jim, Mr. Fletcher, is he there too?
Yes, I believe so.
Your idea of not far.
Didn't take long.
That where your friends live?
That's right.
Well off, are they?
They do all right. Come and meet them.
No thanks.
That wasn't an invitation. Get out of the car. Move.
Look, is this some kind of joke?
Oh, yeah. It's a joke all right, mate. The joke is you don't live long enough to know how it ends. Now get in the house.
Police told me you were here. I thought you might need me.
Need you? Needing you is what caused all this. Because of you, my wife's on the operating table. My kids are dead. Why the hell did you have to turn up?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, that lot of good that's gonna do.
Fletcher. I'm sorry. We did everything we could, but...
Mrs. O'Connell, would you please tell the court briefly of the circumstances surrounding the crimes for which you were originally sentenced?
Yes. My husband, Eric, did an armed hold-up. He took Davy along with him. I didn't know about it until it was too late.
And then they returned to your home after the crime?
Yes. Well, it was their home, too.
Quite. And subsequently, you hid their presence from the police and helped them get away from the city?
Yes.
And after that, you were arrested and sentenced to 5 years for aiding, abetting, and accessory after the fact of armed robbery?
Yes.
Mrs. O'Connell, you have two other children, do you not?
Yes, Andrew and Emma.
And what happened to these children at the time of your arrest?
My mother looked after them.
Are they still with your mother?
No. They had to go to a home. My mother's sick. She had to have an operation. And she found the kids were getting a bit too much for her. Oh, not that they're bad kids, Your Honor. They're just normal kids.
Mrs. O'Connell, we understand you have now divorced your husband.
Yes, Your Honor. Miss Jeffries thought it best.
Miss Jeffries?
Miss Angela Jeffries, Your Honor, an associate of mine. She acted on behalf of Mrs. O'Connell during the divorce proceedings.
Oh, yes. Miss Jeffries. Why did she think it was best?
Mr. O'Connell has a long list of convictions, Your Honor, and much as my client loved her husband, she was rather afraid of the influence he might have over her children. Yet another unhappy event in her life brought about through circumstances.
I see. It would seem Mrs. O'Connell has had her fair share of the inequities of life. Miss Saunders, we've heard enough, really, to be able to consider our decision on this case. Is there any other relevant point you wish to raise?
There is one, Your Honor, yes. My client's husband, Eric O'Connell, was convicted of armed robbery, to which my client was an accessory, and sent to Pentridge. 2 weeks ago, he was released on parole. Does it not seem iniquitous that the man who perpetrated the crime has paid his debt to society, whilst the one person acknowledged to have been involved only peripherally is still being punished?
That is indeed a good point, Miss Saunders, and one which we will consider in our deliberations. This court shall adjourn for 1 hour.
This Supreme Court will adjourn for 1 hour. Silence, all stand.
Seems to be going all right, don't you think?
Yes, but don't be too confident.
But the judge said I'd been through a lot, and when you told them about Eric...
Right. You've been convicted and sentenced. Now, for the judges to alter that sentence means, in effect, that they're admitting one of their colleagues was wrong, and they do not like to do that. The law at least must be seen to be unified.
The law. What about justice?
I haven't got a clue.
Don't you reckon Pat should be back from court by now?
Now, how should I know?
Oh, he was hanging about. Pat not back from court, and Fletcher's wife in hospital. Time just seems to drag.
Yeah, well, maybe it wouldn't if you did some work for a change.
So why don't you get on with it instead of just sitting there and thinking about it?
Yeah, you could be right.
Mm.
Is that why you changed your mind about the drama classes?
And what are you on about now?
The drama group. Is that why you decide to go on with it? To keep you busy?
Yeah, that's right.
I don't know how you could work with a bloke like that Pierce, carrying on with a girl young enough to be his daughter.
She was his daughter.
What?
The girl was his daughter.
Oh. Affectionate, wasn't she, for a daughter?
Yeah, well, it's
nice to see a father and daughter close for change.
Are you going out?
Yeah.
Dressed like that?
What do you want me to do? Go out naked? Look, don't come the heavy father routine with me. It's a bit late for that.
Who are you going with?
Kathy.
Kathy? Do you know what she does for a living?
What?
She's a prostitute.
How do you know? You've been one of her customers.
I ought to give you a damn good hiding.
What? You wouldn't have the guts. I thought you were the big-time crim that everyone talked about. But you're nothing.
Make sure you're home at a reasonable hour.
Oh, yeah? And what if I'm not?
Then I'll lock the door.
Well, I'll see you in the morning then, won't I?
Patricia Mary Teresa O'Connell. You were found guilty by a county court of this state of consorting with a known criminal, withholding information from the police, and receiving stolen goods. We consider that the sentence of 2 years imprisonment handed down by that court to be a fitting punishment for those crimes. However, as learned counsel has pointed out, at the time of your trial there was considerable publicity and consequently adverse public opinion against your son, which reflected on your own case. We feel, therefore, in light of the several and diverse personal tragedies which you have undergone, that any degree of leniency considered by that court may have been coloured by that publicity. This court therefore rules that the sentence of 2 years be commuted to 6 months, this term to be served concurrently with the original sentence.
Thank you, Your Honour.
This court will now adjourn, sine die. God save the Queen. Silence. All stand.
Are you all right?
I'm fine.
Shouldn't you be in bed resting?
What for? I've only had a few tests.
It was okay then.
It was horrible.
Well, what did they say?
Nothing. Look, they won't have the results till tomorrow, darling. They're going to bring them in. Dr. Miller will.
Then what was so horrible about it? What have they done to you, Jude?
Nothing. Look, it's just I don't like hospitals, you know. I think it's the smell, you know. Well, even when my mum was in hospital when she was dying, I used to visit her and it used to remind me of death all the time. Stupid, isn't it? You know, when I took those drugs to Chrissy Latham at the maternity ward, I felt sick then.
That's only the antiseptic. It's just to make sure that everything's clean.
I know that. It's just silly, I guess.
Look, don't do that. You should be resting,
please,
Jude.
Please, Sean, let me do this, will you? If I have to go to hospital, I'd like to finish this for you.
This morning? Well, don't tell me you're all having a shower on the same day.
Oh, you know how it is, Vera. You never know who you might run into in here.
Well, if you think it's going to be Ken Pierce, you can forget it, Smith. The governor's given strict instructions. None of you to be left alone with him in future. In fact, you're going to be watched at all times.
Come on, lean forward. There we are. How's it? Better?
I'm fine. Will you stop fussing?
Comfortable.
Oh, you were quick to make your bed, Gilmore. Or didn't you need it last night?
Don't answer her.
And what are you doing still in bed?
She's got doctor's orders.
Yes, well, you haven't, so on your way.
See you later, Jude.
Yeah. You better make the most of it. If you're malingering, we'll soon have you up and working with the rest of them.
Where have you been all night?
It was late, so I stayed at Kathy's.
The door wasn't locked.
Well, I didn't know that, did I?
Where did you get that money?
I won it at the trots.
And where did you get money to bet on the trots?
Kathy gave it to me. And do you want to know where she got it from?
Debbie.
What?
I want you to go back home to your mother.
Oh, why should I? I've only just got away from there. Oh, do you know what it's like stuck in the sticks?
You'd be better off there than here with me.
Anything would be better than being stuck with you.
Then why did you come here?
Because I thought you'd be different. I don't know. I thought we could have a good time together. I don't know how you had the guts to pull those jobs all those years ago.
It had nothing to do with guts. It was pure stupidity. Surely your mother told you that.
Sure, she told me plenty. But if you throw me out of here, I'm not going back home. I'll move in with Kathy.
Oh, sorry, did I frighten you? The back door was out.
Who are you?
I'm a mate of Jim Fletcher's. You remember, we met at the hotel room once.
Oh, yes. What do you want?
I'm looking for Jim, actually. I heard what happened to his wife and kids. He must be going through hell. The trouble is, he didn't go back to the hotel and they don't know where he is.
Well, he's not here.
No, but surely you know where he is. He did tell me that you were close.
Not that close. He's probably gone home.
Yeah, probably. I should have thought of that. There's a copper out the front watching the place. You're in some sort of danger.
Why should I be?
Oh, I don't know. Just Jim's wife and kids getting blown up like that. You being close to Jim. They're probably watching him too.
Probably.
Yeah, well, it's nice to think you're both safe. Still, it's a bit of a worry to think that they didn't stop me getting in here, isn't it?
Ken's here. He's in the rec room.
Well, that lot of good that'll do us with Mrs. Jackson watching all the time.
You should worry. You're going to be out of here in 5 minutes. You'll be able to see all the blokes you want then.
Maybe. But I haven't heard from the parole board yet, remember? Anyway, I was thinking about you.
I'll manage.
Maybe I could do me old bad ticker routine.
Oh, I'm not going to fall for that again, Lizzie. Everything all right?
Oh, yes, but I could think of better things to do than stand here staring at them all day.
You heard Mrs. Davidson's orders.
Yes, but what harm would it do if B did speak to him?
Do you think all she'd do is talk? Have you forgotten what happened between that electrician and Marilyn Mason?
I can hardly see Smith clambering up a ladder into the ceiling. Not for Ken Pierce or anyone else.
Oh, well, Ken Pierce isn't the only visitor we've got. Greg Miller's here too.
Oh, where is he?
In reception. He's here to see Bryant and then he's going straight up to Queensland.
Look, I'd like to say goodbye to him. Could you keep an eye on things here for me?
Sorry, I'm busy.
See where she's gone, Lizzie.
Nowhere inside.
Come with me.
Oh, B, I don't want to be a gooseberry.
I need you to be a cockatoo, you idiot. Good day.
Hey, should you be here?
Oh, why not?
Well, if one of the guards catches you.
All right, Lizzie's here to keep watch.
Well, I still don't think it's a very good idea. Mrs. Davidson's already been on to me about our meeting in Paul's office the other day. If she finds out about this...
Look, I didn't come here for a lecture.
I just don't want to see you getting into trouble, that's all.
How's Debbie?
Oh, I don't know, Bea.
It's funny meeting your daughter for the first time after all these years. I just don't know her. She's a stranger. You know, she didn't even come home last night, and you want to see that crowd she hangs out with.
Well, that's easily fixed. Give her a good clip around the ear. It's not as if she's too old.
Yeah, but I am. I should have been with her when she needed me 15 years ago.
Oh, well, you couldn't help that.
I could have kept her out of trouble. We both could.
Well, at least you got a second chance. Oh, bloody kids, they're nothing but trouble. You should let me have a word with her. I'd soon straighten her out.
Why, doubt that. You'd be her hero, you know that? Sometimes I think that's her only ambition. To be top dog in a place like this.
A day in here would soon change her mind.
Yes. Yes, it might.
Good day, Mrs. Bennett.
Has Birdsworth been in here?
Beg pardon?
Birdsworth, has she been in here?
No, no one's been in since I arrived. Oh, Miss Bennett, is Mrs. Davidson in her office?
Yes.
Do you think I could see her, please?
I'll ask her.
Don't you think I'd better come with you? That way you can keep an eye on me.
Yes, that might be better.
So, when are you heading off home?
Oh, as soon as I see Bryant. Can't say I'd be sorry to leave. Things don't change very much, do they? First Karen, now Jim's wife. Do you ever think about leaving, Meg?
Where would I go? Besides, we can't leave the place to Vera.
Have you seen Jim since?
No, I believe he's at home.
Well, it can't be very pleasant for him on his own. I might call in there after I've seen Bryant.
Well, I think he'd like that. Look, I'm sorry I can't take you along to see her. I'm on duty in the laundry. Officer Barfield, would you mind taking Dr. Miller along to see Bryant, please? Well, I must off. Give my love to Karen.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Miss Bennett.
No, thank you, Mrs. Davidson. Actually, I've got rather a lot to do before our staff meeting this morning.
Well, we won't keep you then, will we? Now, Mr. Pierce, what can I do for you? You're not thinking of leaving after our little chat yesterday, I hope.
Oh, no, no, no. Actually, this has nothing at all to do with the drama group. Not directly, anyway. Have you heard of that scheme the recidivist group in Parramatta Prison are running? They're bringing in young people who've got themselves into scrapes, showing them how they'll end up if they don't mend their ways.
Yes, it's an American idea. I do try to keep up with the latest developments in prison work.
Yes, of course. Mrs. Davidson, have you thought of starting anything like that here?
Well, we're not really equipped for it. It's only been tried in the large maximum security establishments where the full effect of prison can be brought home. I don't think anyone would be scared straight by Wentworth.
A young, impressionable girl might.
Did you have anyone specifically in mind?
My daughter.
I see.
You see, I was inside while she was growing up, but I feel I owe it to her now to help her.
I'm sure you do, but these schemes are fraught with danger. Your daughter would be our responsibility if she were hurt.
No, I'm sure she'll be okay if the women cooperate.
Well, it's not up to the women to decide. I have to discuss it with my staff and the department. Does your daughter have a record?
Not yet, but it's only a question of time.
Well, I'll raise it at the staff meeting, but my own feeling is the risk is too great.
Oh, don't get up.
Oh, it's no trouble.
How are you feeling?
Fine.
I don't think that's quite true, Judy, otherwise you wouldn't be sitting in here resting. I understand you usually work in the garden.
Yeah, but it's not much of a garden, is it? I mean, there's only so much I can do, you know?
I got the results of your tests.
Yeah? Well, what's the bad news?
Well, actually, it isn't that bad. You've got what's called an intermittent blockage.
What's that?
Well, it means that one of the valves in your heart occasionally fails to open. That's when you pass out. We didn't notice it before because your blood pressure was high and there was sufficient pressure to force the valve open.
Well, we'll have to keep the blood pressure up then, won't we?
Well, it's not that simple. And the extra strain could only make it worse. But fortunately, nowadays, there is a solution. A pacemaker.
You mean surgery?
Yes, but very successful surgery. The success rate now is over 93%.
Well, I wasn't too good at math, but I think that means that 7% is unsuccessful.
Well, that's better than the alternative, Judy.
I'm coming.
Oh, great.
Sorry, trouble you, Jim. You want to pick up?
Sure, sure.
Sorry about the mess, you know.
Oh, it's all right. What, are you here on your own?
Who'd you expect to be here?
Well, no one. I was stopped by the police outside. I thought there might be more of them in here.
No, they wanted to. I wouldn't let him.
Wouldn't that be safer?
He wouldn't have the guts to face me himself.
But you know who did it, then?
Oh, yeah, I know.
Look, Jim, I do know how you must be feeling. And with Karen. I think it'd be better if you weren't on your own at the moment. Isn't there somebody you could stay with? Family or friends? Well, what about Leela's family?
No, there's only her father. He didn't approve of me anyway. He'd have figured this was all my fault.
Well, look, if there's anything I can do, anyone I can contact.
Yeah, no, thanks.
Okay.
Look, there's one thing.
Yeah?
Have you got anything there that might help me sleep? You know, every time I close my eyes, I just see the kids.
Do you think that's wise? I mean, if you're in danger here.
I can't stay awake forever. Besides, the police are outside.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks.
These are pretty good. There's no after effects. I'll just give you a couple at the moment. If you feel like you need any more, then see your local doctor, okay?
Good.
You shouldn't mix them with alcohol.
Well, I'm not going anywhere. All I want to do is sleep.
Naturally, Mr. Fletcher will not be attending the meeting today.
When will he be back?
We don't know at this stage.
Oh, it'll mean more work for us.
I have applied to the department for a temporary replacement.
Have you heard from Jim?
No, but I intend visiting him after work.
Well, may I come with you?
Yes, of course. Now, before we get on to the general business, I have a request from Ken Pierce. He would like his daughter to spend 24 hours here at Wentworth.
What does he think it is, a holiday camp?
Far from it. The girl has been getting into bad company. He thinks a short spell in here might sort her out.
That's hardly our job, is it? They're social workers and parole officers for that sort of thing. Not that they have much success.
Well, you only see our failures.
And there are enough of
them. All right, all right. The girl has not been in trouble yet, so she hasn't come to the notice of the authorities. Mr. Pierce is trying to prevent that.
And it has been tried elsewhere with considerable success.
Yes, but that's only after careful preparation and screening. I hardly think we're equipped for that sort of thing. And besides, half the women would treat it as a joke. They'd encourage the girl rather than frighten her.
Yes, that is a possibility.
Anyway, what's the point? With a father like her, she'll find her own way in here sooner or later.
Which is precisely why we should give it a go. If her downfall is imminent, we should do everything we can to prevent it.
Very well, I shall ask the department for permission. Now, I have some news from the parole board about the O'Connell case.
What's that, Pat?
What?
This lot hasn't been washed.
Oh, sorry, I wasn't thinking.
Well, I think that's exactly what you were doing. About the parole board, right?
Yeah. Well, they must have met by now. It looks like they're not going to let me off.
Oh, now, come on. If three Supreme Court judges reckon you've got a fair chance, them ratbags on the parole board ought to.
Yeah, but will they? They enjoy sitting up there playing God.
Go on, you'll be right as rain. You'll see. Oh, well, that's it for the day, girls. You can all go home and come back again tomorrow.
Yeah. I think I'll call into the pub on my way home.
Come on, everybody, into the garden. You have an exercise period.
Oh, whoopee.
Not you, Pat.
Why?
You've got to collect your things and go to reception. You've got your parole.
Oh, what did I tell you?
Good on you. Well, go and get your stuff and get out of here. Go on.
I knew she'd get it.
Yeah, and so she bloody well ought to, too.
Hi. Pat got a parole. They're saying goodbye to an hour out in the garden. Are you going to get dressed and come outside?
No, I don't think I want to see anybody going out of here at the moment.
Oh, Jude. The doc reckoned it was a real safe operation, didn't he? Well, then...
Look, I'm sorry. I just can't help how I feel, Sharon.
Well, that's just because you're inside, stuck in here on your own. Come outside where there are other people.
Look, you go if you want to, huh?
No. If you're not going, neither am I.
Well, come on, this is an exercise period. Can you walk around and give those legs of yours some exercise?
Nah, we thought we'd just stand here and grow varicose veins, like yours, Vera.
Yeah, you two can have a body like mine.
If you're not very careful.
Shut up, you two.
Are they Pat's kids?
Yeah, poor little beggars. Must seem like Christmas to them getting their mum back.
Will you move?
Well, what would you rather, Vera, a touch of the Charleston or a bit of disco?
Here she is.
Come, my love. Good luck.
Thanks, Bea.
Bye-bye, Lizzie.
If you've got nowhere to stay, I can phone Rhonda and she can put you up in the halfway house.
Oh, we'll be right. Thanks, Lizzie. You look after yourself.
Moon kids.
Bye, Doreen. Well, I hope I'll see you all again soon. Certainly won't be in here.
Mummy, Mummy!
Hello, darlings.
Are you really coming home, Mum?
Yes, I am, sweetheart. This time for good. Thanks, Mrs. Jackson. Goodbye, Pat.
I'll take that. Well, who wants to ride in the back seat with Mum?
Me.
Come on, then.
Wake up, mate. Jimbo, wake up.
Oh,
wake up.
Hmm? Oh, Jeff. What are you doing here, mate?
Well, I heard you're in a bit of trouble. I thought I'd better come round and help you out of it.
It's really good of you, mate, you know. Shouldn't have bothered.
Oh, it's no bother, mate.
I wish he could again, but that was on the outside, and things were different then. On the inside, the sun still shines, and the rain falls down, but the sun and rain are prisoners too. to ride.